What if the system that feeds the world was also a key to solving climate change? It's true. The soil under the farmer's feet is an enormous carbon sink. Now, agriculture is behind how we feed our population, and farmers have worked tirelessly to feed an ever-growing population. That focus on production has been helpful, but that focus has had unintended consequences. At this point, agriculture accounts for roughly 1/5 of global emissions, and soils have been eroded. But that means that reducing emissions from agriculture is a major opportunity. And what if we go beyond just reductions and we capture CO2 from the atmosphere and restore soils using nature's own direct air capture technology, photosynthesis? Then we can start to make progress. I have the incredible privilege of working with a team of scientists, data scientists, engineers, and we're working to take satellites, biogeochemistry, and machine learning and help farmers unlock sustainable agriculture's potential to have an impact of 4 gigatons of CO2 impact a year. Now, we talk about tons of CO2 a lot. What does that look like? It looks sort of like that. So imagine now 4 billion of those giant balloons. That's the potential impact we can have. Great, well, how do we do it? There are many sustainable agricultural practices. Here's just a few: cover crops, no-till, diverse crop rotations, irrigation management. These all can help reduce emissions, and they can help us actually pull carbon and put it into soil. And we know this because of farmers who have led the way. Meet Ken and Rodney Roulon. Ken and Rodney are two brothers that farm in central Indiana. About 25 years ago, they made a decision to go no-till. That means they stopped turning over the soil between crop harvests. They did this largely out of economic reasons. It was cheaper and they had to find ways to make the farm survive. But then they noticed differences in the soil. They started doing crop rotation, and they added cover crops. So now they have living roots in the soil year-round, undisturbed. And it's paid off. You see, by building the soil carbon, the Roulons have also been building their land's capacity to absorb and retain water. Speaking with Ken, he mentioned how in the past few drought events in the last 20 years, you know, the county averages for their area have seen corn production and yields drop by 30% when they've only taken a 5% hit. Speaking with him this week, he said it's another dry year and they're on track for record corn harvest. Great, so why aren't all farmers doing this? Implementing these sustainable practices right takes time and effort. And if you don't get it right, you can impact yield. And that's the farmer's key revenue. So yield, it's pretty easy to measure. You harvest the grain, it goes on a scale, you weigh it, you get paid. How can we make it that easy for farmers to measure the sustainability of their farming and get paid for it? First, we need to find ways to measure the ecosystem impacts, the CO2 emissions, the carbon in the soil, the water. But measuring molecules in a field is hard, especially trying to do it cost effectively. Once we can do that, we have a second challenge. You know, we need to connect the farmers creating that impact with companies that actually care and are willing to value that. But our supply chain has evolved for aggregation. That makes it difficult to connect the finished products to the fields where the raw ingredients came from. We have to solve both a measurement problem and a connection problem. We have solutions to both. To solve the measurement problem, we created a powerful quantification engine. This has let us take and really build on the science that's been done for decades on the biogeochemistry of agriculture. This maps interactions between the plants, the soil, the environment, and farm management events. We take all of this information and create the mathematical relationships to put them into models. Our quantification engine uses process-based models, machine learning models, and life cycle analysis models to understand what's happening from farm management events and give us an idea of what are the actual sustainability impacts of those. Now, we test and validate our models by comparing them to long-term experiments and measurements on these different properties because we want to make sure we know that they actually work. We've put our work through scientific peer review because the stakes are too high for our planet to get this wrong. With all of that, we have a way to measure impact now. That also solves a problem for companies who are looking for measurable and reliable ways to invest in sustainability. But the problem is that many of these companies don't have that much visibility into which farmers are in their supply chain. They're usually buying from an aggregator, and that aggregator is the one who's either buying from a co-op or from the farmer directly. And when you start to map out the full supply chain, it quickly becomes complex with many points of trade. So we need to find a way to help companies know where their field supplies came from. We've solved this connection problem, bringing together satellite imagery, optimization, and machine learning. So now, using this, companies can get visibility into which fields feed into the elevators that supply them. And not only that, but what crops are they growing and with what sustainable practices. We can put that all through our quantification engine and help companies see, what is my footprint in agriculture? Armed with this knowledge, companies now have two different options for ways to lower their emissions. Number one, they can either pay farmers for low carbon crops that were produced on fields already using sustainable practices for a long time, or they can create incentives and help pay farmers for the impacts of transitioning to these sustainable practices. I'll share examples of how we're using each approach already to help farmers, companies, and the planet. We'll start with Arkansas. Arkansas is the biggest rice-producing state in the U.S. Over 200 million bushels of rice come out of Arkansas a year. The majority of it is grown in flooded conditions. Again, it's about yield. This helps suppress weeds and guarantee a good outcome and yield. But as you might imagine from the word flood, it uses a lot of water. And it can cause fields to emit methane, which is a really powerful greenhouse gas. One sustainable practice that farmers can use for rice is an irrigation management technique where you limit the flooding to just specific periods of time. By doing this, you can still protect your yields, but really reduce the amount of water you use and reduce your emissions. Starting in 2019, we've used our quantification engine to help farmers in Arkansas get paid for growing rice and delivering it using sustainable practices like this and others. Over 9 million bushels of sustainable rice have been delivered to companies like Anheuser-Busch. Now, the rice that was grown with this has a major impact. We compare this to other rice grown in the region, and those 9 million bushels were grown with 20,000 fewer tons of CO2 impact. And that rice was produced with 7.4 billion less gallons of water. Now, 7.4 billion gallons of water, that's roughly the amount of water that about 240,000 Americans use in a year. That's a different story. But 240,000 is bigger than Little Rock, a big city in Arkansas. So Arkansas, you should raise a glass to those rice farmers. Now, what about the second option? What about going beyond reductions and actually achieving soil carbon removals? That gets us to our second example. Using that quantification engine, we've been able to meet the stringent requirements of one of the most reputable carbon registries in the world. This has helped companies like Shopify, Barclays, and the North Face pay farmers that are growing crops like corn, soybeans, wheat, and many other crops, and pay them for the carbon that's stored in their soils as a result of transitioning to some of those sustainable practices like cover crops and no-till. Here, we're quantifying what happened in the soil and what are those changes, net of any emissions, compared to what would have happened if those practices had not been adopted. That difference is the carbon credit. 133,000 metric tons of carbon dioxide have been stored in agricultural soils in a little over 400,000 acres. That's like taking 29,000 cars off the road for a year. Now, 400,000 acres is a good amount of land, but if you put it all in one area, it'd be about the size of that blue dot in Iowa. It's only about 0.1% of cropland in the US. Just by scaling, we have an immediate path to 10 megatons of impact. And if you add in grazing and pasture land and the 12 billion global acres of agriculture, we're getting close to that 4 gigaton impact number. These are not small demos, they're not pilots. These are real, and these are solutions that are here now. Satellites, biogeochemistry, and machine learning have simplified complex measurements and let us actually create value for them. Critically, we've shown it's possible to connect those outcomes across the value chain and recognize and value the farmers stewarding the land. Companies can now understand their agricultural footprint, and they can take action to reduce it, and they must do it now. What if the system that grows the world's food was also a solution to climate change? The answer is under the farmer's feet. If we give sustainable agriculture the value that it deserves, it can scale, and we can achieve 4 gigatons of impact. Thank you.